Hello, Minnesota. Welcome back to the show. I'm Tony Hernandez, and this is the Tony Hernandez Show. Today is Saturday, February 9th. We got another great lineup of people that are going to be coming on today. In a little bit, I'm going to be speaking with David Martinez. He recently announced his candidacy for the St. Paul School Board. After that, we're going to be talking to Brandon Carmack. We're going to be discussing local issues, Highland Park issues, some politics, and some other things. And in the middle, we're going to hear from Jake Duesenberg. I went over to the La Casa de Duesenberg yesterday, and we shot a little presentation. Jake is a military member, and he brought out some of his guns. And he's also explaining and informing you, the audience, about new proposed gun restrictions, legislation, the issues surrounding gun violence in America and whatnot. So first of all, I want to say congratulations to my good friend, St. Paul native Matt Burke. Him and the Baltimore Ravens were victorious on Super Bowl Sunday. It was a huge, huge pride in St. Paul for Matt Burke, and we're just happy that he won his first Super Bowl and wish him the best. And it's interesting, too, that I heard quite a few different murmurings on Facebook and on Twitter about Matt Burke and potentially running for the United States Senate. I don't know if there's any truth to these rumors or whatnot, but we'll definitely keep you in touch with that and find out what the latest is in terms of that. Secondly, there was a big news story about drones in America. In particular, there were some documents that were released by the Obama administration to various news organizations in regards to U.S. policy of using drones to attack Americans or to assassinate Americans overseas. And it's pretty interesting, though, the controversies that this brings up, because we actually have a U.S. Presidency and administration that is talking about killing Americans overseas and justifying this type of force, which I find alarming. But, you know, I did some research on it, actually. And in terms of the drones, a February 2012 Washington Post ABC poll showed that 8 in 10 Americans, 83%, approve of the Obama administration using unmanned drones against suspected terrorists overseas, with a whopping 59% who are approving of the practice. So this just goes to show you that the administration and the sentiment for the American people out there is in favor of these drones. And it said that 58% of the people polled support the idea of the American government using drones to kill Americans overseas, so long as those Americans are labeled as suspected terrorists. And I think that this is an extremely dangerous precedent to go down. But it's pointed out that, you know, this actually, the idea of liberty versus security is as age old as the great emancipator, Abraham Lincoln. He famously sidestepped Congress and suspended habeas corpus during the Civil War time to arrest Confederate sympathizers. Franklin D. Roosevelt, the famous progressive U.S. president, he was responsible for the internment in camps of literally hundreds of thousands of Japanese American citizens. And he did this basically with the approval of the American people. And so it is something, though, that we have to make light of, or we have to pay attention to, because more and more drones are showing up over American skies. And it begs the question of our own personal liberty and whether or not the government may find one day to use this type of a justification to go after perhaps you or your family. So just something to think about. It's something that we should definitely be cognizant of. I'm about to bring on David Martinez. He is running for the St. Paul School Board. And in light of his being here, I looked up some statistics in terms of educational issues in America. And according to the data from the Center of Education Statistics, 88.2% of Minnesota students graduated after 4 years in high school. that actually puts us at the very top of the nation. And you really have to dig into the statistics a little more to find out what is really going on here in Minnesota. And new federal data this week indicated that Minnesota actually ranks last in four-year graduation rates for Latino and American Indian students. It's second to last in the nation for Black students and at the very bottom for low-income families. So if you're a low-income family in Minnesota, if you're a Latino American or African American, Asian American, the statistics are showing that these students are not graduating at high enough rates and their proficiency in math and other subjects are actually lower than their white student counterparts. So with that, I'll bring on our guest, David Martinez. David, thank you so much for being on the show.
Thanks for having me.
It's great to have you. And you made an announcement this week. Do you want to just tell the audience a little more about that?
Absolutely. So I've been involved in the school districts for a number of years, probably 7-8 years in one capacity or another, as a volunteer, as a mentor, as a translator. I translate for the Spanish-speaking families. And in 2011, there was an open seat on the school board. And I put my name kind of in the hat and was a finalist. So I was being considered to fill that seat. And recently, members of the school board, community folks who know who I am and my interest in education have encouraged me to run for the open seat on the school board. And I've decided that I'm not too young to run. And I was mentioning to you that you were partly responsible for my decision. You didn't know this, but I met you last year when you were campaigning, and I looked at your background, your age, and I could relate to, you know, we're the same age, we share a lot of similarities in terms of our careers, and you ran for a very high profile office. So seeing that made me realize that I'm not too young, that there's no better time to do this than right now. And I reached out to you, and you were so kind to allow me to sit with you and talk about this and introduce me to the people of St. Paul, so I appreciate that.
Well, it's great to have you here, and I definitely, anytime I see young people out there that are willing to make better communities, to make stronger schools, to build a better future for Minnesotans, it definitely gets me excited, so I'm glad that you're here, and I hope, you know, this, we're going to take this time to really introduce who David Martinez is to the audience, and I hope that you're able to come back a little later as your campaign progresses more, and perhaps we'll focus even more on the issues. What did you think about some of those statistics, you know, that I cited in terms of the achievement gap here in Minnesota? It's pretty alarming to me.
It is, and it's probably the number one thing that is being talked about in the St. Paul schools. There's a lot of money and resources and people being allocated to address the achievement gap because it's been pointed out at the federal level. You know, Minnesota still is regarded, like you said, and like the statistics say, as a state with very good education. Families still move here, and St. Paul specifically, for the quality of education. But if you look at how the Latino families, the poor families, and other minority groups, it's not a pretty picture. And that's part of why I'm running. What I'm hearing in the community as well is, you know, in order to close the achievement gap, in order to get more engagement, more parent engagement from these communities, we need someone from that community. We need someone who's talented. We need someone who is aware of the issues. We need someone who can speak the language to come in and run for office. I mean, that's not a guarantee that you'll win, but it seems like more and more that's what's being asked. And there don't appear to be too many candidates that fit that profile, and I think I fit that profile well. And here I am. I have a 5-year-old son who's entering the St. Paul Public Schools next year, so that's another reason why I'm running. And, you know, the school district is coming off a lot of great accomplishments. They just passed the levy. They renewed that levy, so there's additional funds coming in for technology enhancements. Enrollment is up. I think we're now the largest school district in Minnesota or close to it. So a lot of good things going for St. Paul Public Schools right now. And what I hope the residents of St. Paul will realize is that they now have representative from the Latino community. His name is David Martinez, and I have a lot of energy and interest around this topic, and that I'm in it for the right reasons, and that I'll be calling on all of them, all 300,000 or so, to vote for me come November 5th.
Well, let's talk a little more, first of all, of your personal history. Yeah. Were you born and raised in St. Paul?
Or? No. So, and that's great that we're starting there, because I think people need to understand my background in order to understand why I'm running. So this will take about 8 minutes and we can have a conversation. Sure. So I've broken it up into my childhood, which did not start in St. Paul. I was born in Puerto Rico, actually. And my mother and father separated when I was young. And this story is becoming increasingly common among students and families in St. Paul, which is another reason why I'm a good candidate. 10 years ago, my story was very unique, right? First generation Latino student, English language learner. So I learned English in the St. Paul public schools. So a big reason or a big part of how I'm able to have this conversation with you is because the St. Paul Public Schools gave me the ability to speak English. And it was through their investments in English language learner programs that I'm able to communicate this effectively with you today. So I entered the third grade, learned English in St. Paul schools, and then from there I went on to the University of Minnesota through a program that a lot of people call an affirmative action program. It was an intake program for students that were good students. So I had almost a 3.0 GPA in high school. I took the ACT, did okay on it, but I was still a high risk student, meaning there were very slim chances that I would continue on to college because no one in my family knew how that process worked. So the University of Minnesota had a program that intentionally went out and searched for these kids. And they found me, luckily, and I applied and I got in and graduated from the University of Minnesota. So again, investment in programs, whether they be affirmative action or otherwise, that allow children from underrepresented groups, underprivileged, whatever you want to call it, to have a shot, you know, are things that I support. I benefited from those programs. And, you know, those are things that I'll fight for as a member of the St. Paul Public Schools. I also met my wife in college. That's a whole nother story that we won't get into today. Mm-hmm. But I did want to share a couple of stories from college. So when I was in college, I already shared the Summer Institute program, the intake program. When I was there, I partnered with 11 other guys, and we started the first Latino-based multicultural fraternity in the state, known as Sigma Lambda Beta. And it was a group that was the principals, our brotherhood, scholarship, leadership, community service, and cultural awareness. Those are all principles that we grew up with. They're principles that are very kind of relevant and top of mind within diverse communities. And we formed this group. We have an 85% graduation rate. That's wow. Amazing. A lot of us are first-time college graduates. And I give...
First time, you mean coming from families with
yep.
a person graduating for college for the first time?
Yes, in their families. And I credit my graduation from the university to that group of guys because I hit a number of kind of pits during my career in college, and those guys were there to lift me up and encourage me to continue and kind of refocus. And the third story that I'll share with you about the college career was that my first real job was with the Minnesota Department of Education as an intern. And again, it was a program that they had, affirmative action. It's called the SEEDS Internship Program. And the goal of the program was to bring students in, first-time college, first-generation college students, to bring them into like that corporate or professional environment and give them an idea of what it's like to work in an office. So my job was actually to audit state and federally funded projects across the state, specifically around prevailing wage. And it was there that I had the first glimpse at the inequities that exist in our system, specifically in the labor sector. And what I mean by that is that on almost every job that I would audit, where there was a large Latino or immigrant workforce, there were prevailing wage violations. And the most rewarding thing for me was, you know, I'm a 22-year-old kid, 21-year-old kid going on this site, and the foreman's running up to me saying, you know, you can't talk to these guys. How dare MnDOT send, you know, a Spanish-speaking auditor out here, right? So it was fulfilling for me to represent the Latino workers, but it was also sad to see that those kind of issues existed. So those were the stories I wanted to share about kind of college and my involvement mm-hmm. with the Latino community, just to let the public know that I have been an advocate for Latino communities, Latino families, Latino issues, and education is really the Achilles heel of our community. Until we get our education levels up, it's going to be kind of continued challenges. We may lose another generation, and I don't want that to happen. I was close to falling through the cracks myself, but thanks to the investments that Minnesota and St. Paul made in programs geared at kind of sealing up some of those cracks, I am now able to sit here and say, you know, first person to graduate from college, first person to get their master's degree, first person to work in a professional environment. I've been at Wells Fargo for 11 years. First person to run for office. You know, this is all new to my family. And I told my mom that I was running for the first time yesterday, and she was like, she didn't know what to say. She's like, oh my goodness, do you want me to like cook you some food so we can do a fundraiser? People love my food. We'll
Great
sell
idea.
It. Yeah. So it's exciting, you know, and that, you know, just even running, it creates a sense of pride in the community,
oh, yeah.
you know, which is great. And it goes back to my point about you running. You know, you influence me running, who knows, will influence some other young people. So it's great.
Yeah, and I remember the Cinco de Mayo parade this year. It was actually the day after Leona and I got married. We got married on May 4th, which was a Friday, and the Cinco de Mayo parade was the next day. And of course, we went to the parade because we were mm-hmm. had the full swing of the campaign. But I'll never forget going down Cesar Chavez and seeing the kids on the street, and a couple of them pull out their IDs. And they were looking, they were like, we got the same name, you know, mm-hmm. they, like that. And you could just see mm-hmm. it in their eyes. So I definitely believe what you say in terms of inspiring other people to run and to let people in the community know that it is possible, mm-hmm. that there is a route, and that together we can be successful. And I really want to hear a little more about the, mm-hmm. the cultural struggle specific to the Latino community. Mm-hmm. In particular, you mentioned English and how you learned English in grade school. Mm-hmm. And that's a problem with many of the Latino students is mm-hmm. the English proficiency and to be able mm-hmm. to keep up in school with the English-speaking students. And
right.
Can you talk a little more about that?
Absolutely. You know, I've worked with probably hundreds of students, Latino students in the schools. And, you know, what they tell me is that it's difficult because they have so many things on their shoulders that mainstream society doesn't understand or can't relate to, you know. And I'm the oldest of six kids, single parent household, so I understand a lot of those issues and the burden that these kids and the adversity that they have to overcome. First, you're poor, you don't have enough food, usually there's domestic violence, substance abuse issues. You know, I remember going to school with like the same pair of, you know, pants for days at a time. And what happens when you get to school is your friends like make fun of you. People make fun of you. Mm-hmm. And then you go into the cafeteria and you have the different colored lunch ticket that says I'm poor, right? Mm-hmm. So then your friends make fun of you for that. And I'm someone who I didn't have it as bad as what you would traditionally consider a Latino person. I don't look Latino. Nobody ever says, oh, you're Latino. Not even after they know that my last name is Martinez. So I didn't get the worst of it, but I still got picked on. I still had to overcome all of that adversity. And, you know, we look at these kids and we say, oh, you need to learn the language. Well, there's nobody at home to help me with it. So if you're not helping me at school and we're not spending extra time and there's not tutoring available, guess what? When I go home, I just have all of these other issues that I need to face and deal with.
Mm-hmm.
So I think we need to do a better job of understanding that. And another thing we need to do a better job of, in my opinion, is letting these young kids know that, you know, it's not their fault and that we're behind them, that we want them to succeed. But yet, we put up all of these roadblocks or barriers for them, especially for those kids that are dealing with citizenship issues, right? If you have that on your plate on top of everything else, you're basically sitting there thinking, wow, why should I graduate? If I do, how am I going to pay for school? There are no scholarships opportunities for me. It's not my fault, but everybody seems to think it is my fault that I need to go back home. My mom or my dad brought me here, you know, and I was fortunate enough that I came from Puerto Rico where you're born a citizen or you're a citizen, so I didn't have to deal with all of that. And it was hard enough with everything else. So I think we need to just understand all of the factors that are at play before we start jumping to kind of assumptions. But yeah, of course, language, that's like the fundamental. You need to kind of have a good grasp of the language. So continued investments in those programs, I think, is critical.
Sounds good, David. Yeah. Well, we're coming to the end of our segment here, but I was wondering, do you have a website that people could find out more about your campaign? Or?
Not yet. You know, I just announced this week, so this is like my fourth or fifth day in this. I'm still learning how it's all going to work. I'm still looking for a campaign manager, a finance manager, a website guru. So if anybody out there is interested, has experience, please let me know. Right now, you can find me on LinkedIn and on Facebook.
That's David Martinez. Can you spell your last name?
Yes, it's MARTINEZ. And it's a very common name. There are 8 David Martinez's at Wells Fargo, probably hundreds.
Well, Tony Hernandez, I deal with that quite often. If you Google Tony Hernandez, you'll get everything.
So just Google David Martinez, Minnesota. I'm the first result. My LinkedIn profile comes up. That's the best way to reach me, and then on Facebook.
Great. Yeah. Well, and I certainly hope that you can come back to the show maybe in like 2 or 3 months or something, give us more updates, and that way, too, we'll be able to talk more about the issues, which we really want to get into at some point.
Absolutely.
So, David Martinez, thank you very much. Best of luck in your campaign.
Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you. So we have our next little segment that we're going to be doing here. As I said, I was at Jake Duesenberg's house yesterday. We got out his guns, and he talked the guns. We talked the restrictions. There was a lot of news in Minnesota this week in particular surrounding the proposed gun laws and restrictions that are in place. There were a number of hearings that took place where literally hundreds and hundreds of people showed up to voice their opinions and to see, you know, what was going to be happening at the state capitol. So we're going to play our video that we shot yesterday. Dallas, if you want to get that lined up, and we'll get it going. Violence, new proposed legislation for gun control, gun restrictions. And Jake, thanks for being here, and thanks for having me in your house.
Yes, definitely.
And well, can you first of all talk about just a little bit more about your credentials?
Sure.
Why you know so much about guns and everything?
Well, aside from being an investment advisor and talking about economics all the time, I'm also a 13-year Army veteran, served time in Iraq and also Kosovo. And all that time was in the infantry, and 8 years of that time was actually as a commissioned officer.
Nice. Well, thank you for your service.
Well, definitely.
And well, let's get right into it. Now, this was a big week
in terms of
news in Minnesota for gun restrictions. There were committee hearings. A lot of people are energized and passionate about these issues on both sides.
You noticed.
Yes. And I don't know, there was also a poll that came out that said nearly, I think it was 59 or 60% of Minnesotans are in favor of some type of gun control or new gun restrictions. What do you think about that?
Yeah, I think it's an education issue, really, to be honest with you. People don't understand what these weapons are that they're referring to, that they're actually safe firearms when they're in the hands of a law-abiding citizen. No one out here is arguing for a criminal and a person that's very mentally disturbed to have a gun, but what we don't want to do is take guns away from law-abiding citizens, and I think there needs to be a little bit more education to the public so people understand why these guns are actually something that guys like myself use.
So would that actually happen then if some of this legislation actually does pass and Governor Dayton
signs it into law, then the effect would be that guns would be taken away from law-abiding citizens, and the possession of certain firearms would be considered a felony.
That's right. I mean, the majority of these bills that we'll be talking about today would either A, make me pay money out of my pocket for some kind of fee to have a permit, or what they'll do is they'll make me submit my weapons to a law enforcement official or get it out of the state of Minnesota, and if I don't comply with that law, then I would be a felon and could serve up to 5 years in prison. And three of those laws would actually apply to a guy like me.
So you have some of your guns here, but first let's talk about some of the specific pieces of legislation that are being proposed, who's proposing them, what it would do if passed, and how it would affect people. So do you want to start?
Yeah, well, let's take one off this list here. I gave you a copy, HF241, which was introduced by, I think it's Michael Paymar.
Representative Paymar.
He chairs the House Committee on Public Safety. And what that one is specified for is what they call so-called assault rifles. And I brought the Bushmaster 223. This is what they're referring to. And I can understand from a lot of people's perspective that looks like a very intimidating firearm.
So this is the, so-called AR?
Yes, this is the AR platform. And when I refer to that, it's the basically the look of it, the telescopic buttstock, the pistol grip, and the flash suppressor here.
And this was the gun that the killer used in the Aurora, Colorado shootings in the movie theater?
I believe he used a Bushmaster-style weapon, and I don't believe this was used at all during the Sandy Hook incident.
Okay.
So this is a semi-automatic weapon. This is one of the fallacies that's been talked about. When I say semi-automatic weapon, you can see here there's a S for safety, which the weapon's usually on unless you're ready to fire the weapon. And then there's an F for fire. Now, on a military-style firearm, which is what a lot of these laws are written to, they're referred to in these laws, there's actually another switch here, and that's called a three-round burst. And the A1 M16, that was actually a fully automatic feature. The three-round burst is automatic, but it only is limited to three rounds. So you pull the trigger and it shoots three rounds right in a row. Mm-hmm. The civilian models do not have that. So the way this firearm fires is you pull the trigger once and one bullet leaves the gun, and then it ejects that round and then puts another round in, and you'd have to pull the trigger again. So one of the big fallacies is that you pull the trigger and it just sprays bullets. And in fact, I even heard that in the congressional hearings this week, that these fully automatic, that they're spraying bullets, and that's just absolutely not true. These firearms are just like a lot of common hunting rifles, that you pull the trigger once and that's all it shoots is one round.
So this gun would be considered illegal if Representative Paymar's bill passes.
Right.
And why specifically would it be illegal? Because of...
Sure. As I mentioned, a lot of firearms have the, hunting firearms have the semi-automatic feature, so it's actually nothing to do with this. It's absolutely nothing to do with the size round that it is as well. This is a 223 round, that's what it shoots. Actually a very small round, and I brought a couple comparisons here. If you want to hold that up.
Sure.
This is a 270 round. This is a very common deer hunting rifle round, and you can tell that the size of the 223 round is actually quite small, comparatively speaking. And if you consider this casing here is where the gunpowder is put, and this bullet is the thing that leaves the rifle, it's the projectile, you can tell that this is also a bigger round, that the projectile, and then also has far more power. I also brought a 300 Win Mag, another bigger round. I don't know if you can hold it all up there. That just shows another bigger round. Now, these are two common hunting rounds that are used in the Midwest and out West. And then also a 12-gauge shotgun shell, which is a very powerful weapon up at close ranges.
So how come this one has the red top here?
Just the manufacturer's way to do it. Yeah. So anyhow, so you can see from the comparisons here that a 223 round is actually quite small as far as rounds go. So that's not what they're going after. What they're really going after to make it the so-called assault rifle is they want to see a cosmetic feature, and a couple cosmetic features, and one in particular is the telescopic buttstock. That means I can move this buttstock back and forth in different positions, right? Now, why that makes this weapon more dangerous, I have no idea. What I see it as an advantage is for somebody, a normal guy like me, very comfortable shooting at this distance, you know, my long arms, but a person that's smaller, maybe has shorter arms, in particular a woman, they're able to have this fit very comfortably. So absolutely nothing that renders this gun more dangerous in that sense. So the other thing that they want to do in another part that would make an assault rifle is a 30-round magazine. Now, there's no evidence that this is going to bring down crime at all.
So 30 rounds just means there's a bullet, 30 bullets that go from the top all the way down.
Exactly. And even in the legislature right now, we have two different bills, and they can't even agree on the size of rounds that are dangerous. There's one bill that says 7 and another one that says 10. They don't have any idea. So there's really no proof that a 30-round magazine is going to be any more dangerous. And quite frankly, anyone that's got good training could pop that round out, put another round in, and let's say it was max to 10 capacity, in a matter of a second. So really, there's not a huge advantage in having that 30-round magazine if you're trying to, you know, carry out some kind of awful, attack on a school or a movie theater, as you mentioned before.
So a skeptic may say, then, what do you need a 30 magazine round?
You know, it's a valid question. I mean, I don't usually look at why you don't need it. I look at why would anyone try to take that away from someone? I mean, maybe I have no reason for a 30-round magazine, but another guy says I'm a competitive shooter, and 30-round magazines is what we use for our course. Another person might be a coyote hunter, and there's a pack of coyotes, and they want maximum amount of rounds. Let's say I'm a female, and I'm not a good shot. I'm not very comfortable with firearms, and someone broke into my house at night, and a 30-round magazine gives me that many more rounds in case I need it with an intruder in the house. So I don't really go at why I would need it. I look at, let's not infringe on someone else's right to have it if they need it and if they can justify it.
And I guess for me, the argument that resonates the most is, why would the Minnesota state government want to take something away from law-abiding citizens that they've been able to possess throughout the entirety history of our state?
Well, it's not true. This firearm in particular would have been banned up until 2004 with the federal assault ban. Now, during that period, the Columbine attack occurred. So right there shows that you're not going to stop any mass atrocity by having an assault, so-called assault weapon ban. In fact, there's no evidence that crime has even increased, or mass shootings for that case, has increased since that ban expired in 2004.
And is it true that Connecticut had an assault weapons ban already in effect?
Yeah, I think actually it did. I think they were one of the most extreme gun control states out there. And you don't even have to talk about Connecticut's overall laws. You just look at where these crimes taking place: schools, a gun-free zone, a movie theater, another gun-free zone, mall shootings, right? Gun-free zones. You don't usually hear about mass shootings at gun shows or gun clubs or at at a store that sells
firearms. Although the former assassin, was he a Marine assassin?
Chris Kyle. Yeah.
He was shot.
Navy SEAL
was shot at a shooting range.
Right. Yeah.
So that's a place where you wouldn't expect to get shot.
And no, you wouldn't. And such a tragic incident here. But I mean, generally speaking, I go to my gun club's meeting every month, and there's usually about 40 people with a sidearm, and no one gets shot. It's amazing how that works. The legislative hearings this week, you can actually carry at the Capitol. If you notify public safety, I would say it's safe that there's about 40, 50 people in the room, the committee room, that were carrying a handgun on their side, and no one was shot. So it doesn't necessarily mean just because people have these firearms that there's going to be the Wild West or a bunch of shootings. In fact, I would say the contrary is going to happen. Mm-hmm. More people carrying a firearm is going to actually stop a mass shooting in the future.
Mm. So what other pieces of legislation do we need to go over?
HF 243 is the bill, I got to make sure here if I got that right. I lost my place. Well, I think the 243 was a 7-round mag. It's either 242 or 243. And what that really does is it actually stops people from possessing common firearms like this Beretta 92, which is just a 9mm firearm. And it stops that because it has a 15-round magazine, mm-hmm. right? And they want the capacity to be 7. So it goes back to that argument we had before with the 30-round magazine. You know, maybe I can't justify why I need it, but I'm sure someone else can. I can give you a good case in point. As I mentioned before, a female at home at night, let's say the husband's away on a business trip, and there's an intruder that breaks in the house at night. Well, this is a 7-round magazine. This is a firearm right here I have is a Sig Sauer P238, and there's your little 7-round magazine. I would like for my wife in particular to own this magazine and give her more ability to stop any intruder in the house than have a limit of 7 rounds. So this is really what the legislature is saying. My wife or a female home alone at night can only have this size. They can't have this size, and they certainly don't want her to have this size. And the way I look at it is, I think as many rounds as needed, you know, I'd rather be on the safe side if someone was in the home at night as an intruder and doesn't belong there.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. So what you went to some of the committee hearings this week.
Yep.
What was your overall feeling by attending the hearings? What was the energy of the crowd?
Well, the media doesn't report this too well. The pro-gun people outnumbered the anti-gun people, I would say, 9 to 1, basically. It was amazing how many supporters of the Second Amendment showed up. I heard Tom Hauser of KSTP say, I've never seen a line all of my time reporting at the Capitol, this kind of crowd for a committee hearing. And I actually heard another journalist say the same thing. So, I mean, we had lines 2 hours ahead of time wrapped around the floor where the committee room is. The first day alone, they opened up an overflow room. That filled up, and so they had to open up a second overflow room. That's how many people attended. And we're talking about Tuesday morning, Tuesday evening, and then Wednesday and Thursday mornings and Thursday evening. And we're not talking about, you know, other than the evenings, easy schedules for people. And even at evening, people with kids, very difficult to get down to the Capitol. That just shows that you don't want to mess with people's rights, their liberty. You know, someone in the DFL might understand why a person wants a 15-round magazine, but there are a lot of people out there that understand that this could be a way of life here for them, whether that's recreationally or if it's to save their life, you know, in case there's an intruder in the home.
So were the Democrat politicians, were they receptive to listening to people's concerns about the new restrictions proposed?
If they stood around and actually listened to testimony, I would say yes, but a lot of them actually took off. In fact, one of the...
Wait, you're telling me they didn't actually listen to the people voice their concerns? They actually left without even listening?
Right. I think Michael Paymore, the chair, was probably the only Democrat I had ever saw stay for the whole thing. In particular, the second day when they were introducing HF241, the most extreme of the bills, Michael Paymore actually... or all the Democrats, I think, were gone by the end of the hearing. Representative Hausman actually introduced two bills, and the first time she introduced a bill, she left as soon as she introduced it and didn't stick around for any testimony, even though she said she was going to come back, she took off. And then I believe from reports, I wasn't there on Thursday, but I believe from reports she didn't even show up for her own bill that she was introducing to the committee.
Hmm.
So, no, they didn't stick around at all.
Well, that's good information, Jake, and thanks again for having us at your house to
Definitely.
Look at the different guns that you own here and also how the proposed legislation will affect you and countless other Minnesotans and Americans across this great country.
Yeah, and I want to also give a shout-out to Representative Steve Druskowski. He introduced a bill this week, HF419, and what that does is it actually protects law-abiding gun owners from the federal government imposing their laws on us. And that's really a Second and a Tenth Amendment issue. I believe it's the right of the states to tell the federal government you can't you have to abide by the Constitution, and you don't have the right to enact new laws that are in conflict to that. So it's a great job by Representative Drazkowski. He's got 17 other authors on that bill, and let's hope that passes here in the state.
Nice. Well, yeah. Thank you very much,
definitely.
Jake.
Definitely.
See you soon.
All right.
And we're back. That was shot yesterday at the Casa de Duesenberg, the house of Jake Duesenberg. Usually he's here every Saturday when we broadcast. He is on military duty right now for the weekend, and so he was unable to join us. But Jake will be with us next Saturday, as I hope you are as well. And now I'm going to introduce our next guest. His name is Brandon Carmack, and Brandon was a candidate for the Minnesota State House of Representatives in House District 64B. Currently, the seat is held by Representative Paymar. He's held it for a while, and we were talking about him a little bit in that video because he is one of the people who is authoring one of the pieces of legislation to, I believe, limit the magazine capacity in the guns. But we'll talk to Brandon more about that. So, Brandon, thank you for being on the show.
Yeah, thank you, Tony.
Yeah, so how's everything been going for you since the campaign?
It's been peaceful, but once you've been a candidate, you really don't stop, and you get bit by the bug and you stay active.
Yeah. Well, so I'm glad to see, you know, we had David Martinez on earlier. He's running for the St. Paul School Board, and you know, David's a young guy. He's 33, almost 34, same age as I am. Yeah. How old are you?
25.
You're 25, so you're another person that really is representing the new or the next generation of leaders that are going to work to better our communities, strengthen our education programs here in Minnesota, create more jobs, strengthen the economy, and everything like that. But could you just tell us a little more about what your experiences were from your year of campaigning? What did you learn? What did you like? What did you dislike?
Wow, that's a lot. Yeah, no, the campaign was fantastic. I will always look back on it as that year as definitely challenging, but I'm certainly a better person having gone through it. I look forward to more challenges like it in the future. And, you know, if I could say that I learned anything out of it, it was that it doesn't matter how old you are, you can accomplish something and you can have influence in your community. And I would urge people that, you know, that are 25 plus, 25 minus, you know, to find ways in their group of friends, in their circle of influence to continue to take leadership, to study hard, to know what you believe. One thing about running for office is you need to know it because you will be challenged. And just because everybody in your family believes what you believe doesn't mean that it's not going to be easy to defend. So certainly a lot of study, a lot of confidence in knowing the truth.
And in terms of your interactions with your opponent at the time, Representative Paymar, did you guys get into any big controversies, or can you explain a little more about the interactions that you guys had?
Yeah, I don't know if we got into any controversies. There was a lot being said about some ads that we ran that I don't know how true those allegations were, that we ran some pretty gross ads, some pretty tough ads against him. In our debate, he was extremely, you know, amicable, just very kind. But I felt like he had an understanding of some ads we had run that were incorrect. I did send him a private email one day and just said, hey, whatever it is that you think has been said, I'm making every effort to make sure we're running a respectable campaign. But at the same time, you know, he compared me to previous candidates and said that Brandon was definitely one of the most outspoken, most aggressive in his campaign and wasn't as kind as previous candidates had been to him. And my answer to that was it's true, because I think people are more upset now than they have been previously, and that there needs to be a more solid stance. And, you know, as a young person, I felt like I had some stuff to make up for and that I wanted to be taken seriously and that I wasn't this cute little kid walking around, you know, asking for a vote, but that I wanted to make sure we were promoting some good ideas.
Mm-hmm. And how about, were you working full time?
I was. There were a few different challenges. I had come out of doing some fundraising for some policy organizations. There was some stuff personally with the organization I had been working with. There were some ethical issues that I was not 100% on par with, and we were in the middle of the campaign, and I said I couldn't do it, that I felt like we were crossing some lines, and my wife and I were in agreement that we needed to step away from that position. And really, we just put all our faith in God and said, God, we're running a campaign right now. We don't have time to be in a job transition. But we know you've got your hand on this, and we're trusting you. It was a few months later I was picked up by Wells Fargo, and I've been there ever since. And I maintained a steady track of success there. I'm in my first promotion right now, so that's exciting. And yeah, it was hard. I mean, we were down a few bankers at the branch. We were putting in extra hours, and especially the last 3 weeks before the election, I had to be at work on Saturdays and Sundays as well for different offsite groups. So it was, yeah, it was a challenge.
And the question begs to be asked, are you going to run again in 2014?
yeah, we're thinking about it, seriously. As a result of some things that happened last week at the Capitol, I've received some emails. Apparently, I had no idea, but some petitions are going around asking me to run again. So we are considering it strongly. There's still some more decisions that need to be made.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, of course, 2014 is a non-presidential year, mm-hmm. so those in the urban core may actually see an upswing in some of their numbers, plus we won't have the amendments that drove a lot of the turnout in St. Paul and Hennepin County, Ramsey County, the surrounding areas. So I will definitely keep an eye on that. And you mentioned about what happened this past week in terms of the proposed gun legislation. So I should ask first and foremost, are you in favor of any new laws being passed in Minnesota in order to prevent something like a Sandy Hook or to prevent gun violence here in our state?
There's one law that I would support right now. If we could pass anything in the House, I would like to see somebody step up and say, the only law we're going to pass is that we will not pass any laws that involve the confiscation of our citizens' property for at least the next year. Let's get to the second half of the biennium so that we can step ourselves out of the situation and the emotional drama behind the gun legislation right now and really think seriously about reducing crime. I think right now what is happening in the House is knee-jerk policy reaction to some issues that I'm not sure these reactions are exactly going to reduce crime. And the tensions are so polarized, the politics behind this debate are so polarized that I think it would behoove us as human beings that are educated and that want the best for our communities to say, let's step away from the drama of in the polarization right now and dedicate a full year to true crime reduction, not just political pandering.
Mm-hmm. And by confiscation of citizens' property, just to be clear, I was at Jake Duesenberg's home yesterday, and mm-hmm. Jake is a military member, mm-hmm. and he showed me a couple of his rifles or guns that he has, and in particular the AR-15, mm-hmm. Which would be considered illegal to possess if some of these proposed legislation passes, would in turn, if he keeps those guns, make him a felon, or his other option mm-hmm. is to turn them in mm-hmm. to some type of a law enforcement agency. Mm-hmm. And the other gun that he showed me were the magazines, mm-hmm. with he had one that could carry 30 mm-hmm. rounds in it. Which would be considered illegal possession of those, would be a felony.
Right.
Therefore, you are forcing residents of Minnesota to either send their guns to another state and store them there, or mm-hmm. to turn them over to law enforcement, which I believe is fairly unprecedented in, mm-hmm. in our state's history. Although Jake did point out to me that from 2004 and prior to that, the assault rifles ban was in effect. It was mm-hmm. a piece of federal legislation. So it wasn't until 2004 that they were able to have these types of guns right. here in Minnesota. So going back and forth. But I wanted to ask you, you attended some of the mm-hmm. Committee hearings at the state capitol.
Yes.
Can you explain a little more about how you went, who was there, and...
Right, yeah. Well, I felt particularly passionate because Paymar is chairing the committee, and he was my opponent. I felt like I had an obligation to represent those who asked me to represent them in the last election at this event. When I got there, I will say that I had a lot planned on what I wanted to say, a lot I could have reacted to, but I felt like the arguments were so good in that the pro... Second Amendment individuals were so good at their arguments, it was really non-essential for me to get up and try to interrupt that flow. I also want to point out that Paymer did a fantastic job as chairman. I felt like he was impeccably fair. He did a very good job of maintaining order as a chair of that committee. And I do want to acknowledge that because I think it is worth acknowledging. Beyond that, I think the arguments both for House File 241, 242, and 243, and 240 are all, again, knee-jerk reactions. And I think they demonstrate just how out of touch these anti-gun proponents are with the community of Minnesota. There is absolutely no way that you could attend these meetings this week and come out thinking that the people of Minnesota wanted this. It is a classic, you know, mommy and daddy know what's best for the citizens and we're going to take this away. I think what the left has to reckon with on this issue is a few different things. First of all, Representative Hausman presented the argument that we are an outlier in Europe, from Europe. You know, we look at Europe and all their gun legislations. Why is America an outlier? Why are we allowing all these guns for our citizens? Well, first of all, I think progressives have to reconcile with this argument. The idea that a government would allow its citizens to possess firearms is a revolutionary idea. I mean, if you look at the vast course of human history, we're really the first government to trust its citizens with firearms and with weapons and with guns. And that was something that the Founding Fathers were very clear on, was very intentional. It's the Second Amendment out of 10. You know, that's the second one listed. That's what truly marks freedom. So for being a progressive and for wanting to really push things forward and really bring new ideas and thinking that government is the driving force of progress, by taking away weaponry from your citizens is really an old idea. You're really not being progressive in that argument. So that's the first thing I got out of it that was rather intriguing. Secondly, you know, there's the practical argument as well, as this really seems like the effect of these legislations in particular is going to be we disarm law-abiding citizens. And in any tragic situation, we give the upper hand to a criminal. And I think that's unfortunate. I think it's an unfortunate and unintended consequence of this legislation. You were talking about the magazines. I own a concealed carry weapon. For the conceal part of it, I can only have 7 rounds. So House File 243 by Paymar, that's going to be in my 8-round clip that just is 8 rounds because my pinky allows me to get a little better accuracy. That's going to be illegal. I'm going to be a criminal. And I think what the left has to answer is, why am I one day not a criminal? Why am I one day a trustworthy citizen, having been deemed by the Sheriff's Department as being allowed to have a firearm? Did the events of Sandy Hook change my trustworthy nature of as a citizen? Am I to blame for what somebody else has done that I had no responsibility for? And I think the answer is an overwhelming no. I think those are the type of attitudes and bottom line questions that the left has to address. The legislation is wrong for so many reasons, and those are just a few. But I think it's an unfortunate response, and it can seem that when leadership does nothing in the face of tragedy, when it just sits there and stays quiet and does not react to something like a Sandy Hook, it can seem lamentable by the public. However, I think it's necessary for us to be adults and to say it's unfortunate, but we are dealing with extreme consequences. We need to table this conversation for a year and really look at what needs to happen to prevent crime.
Mm-hmm. Those are some interesting points that you just brought up. Mm-hmm. I know that in Minnesota, for instance, if you look at the difference in terms of the voting population of those of us in the urban core versus greater Minnesota in the other areas of Minnesota, I believe it this issue transcends political party. I believe that in the urban core, you're going to see more people in favor of gun restriction and gun control laws, and people in greater Minnesota doing the opposite. And at the end of the day, what is your opinion if when this goes to a vote, is this going to pass?
I don't think so. I think that the authors of this bill are puppets of public opinion. And I say that cautiously, but I think they are puppets of public opinion. That they do not really have a principle behind this matter. I think they have good intentions, But I think the overwhelming response from the public at the Capitol this week has dominated any ability for this to pass. Mm-hmm. I have full confidence that our leaders will do the right thing.
Mm-hmm. So do you think there's maybe an ulterior motive then why this there's so much drama and so much energy surrounding this issue, or do you?
Well, I mean, the gun issue has been unfortunately an issue of the right or the left for a long time. You know, they've been wanting, Michael Paymar has for a long time promoted domestic safety, albeit in I think if you read through his legislation, you know, mm-hmm. there really is in the things he has promoted, there has been a strong desire on his part to limit the use of guns from the public. What that intention is, I'm not going to allegate on that, or just try to throw out random guesses, but mm-hmm. I think that's been a strong desire from the left. I think they're using the opportunity that this tragedy presents to respond to that and get their ideas pushed in.
Mm-hmm. And you mentioned the Second Amendment mm-hmm. to the United States Constitution, which is the right to bear arms, mm-hmm. the right to have a militia mm-hmm. and whatnot. In your opinion, what was the motivation of the founders to have this amendment in? What is the purpose mm-hmm. for the citizen to bear arm?
Well, put yourself in the seat of the founders. What did they have just gone through? You look at the Revolution, and when you look at the clause in the Constitution and the Declaration that says all men are created equal, that was a statement that says no man has the divine authority to rule over another man. The divine right of kingship had been claimed by the King of Britain. Had then been trumped by Parliament. Parliament was saying they had the divine right to rule other men. And when the founders of the United States Constitution, they got together and they said, no, all men are created equal by God. And all men have unalienable rights. Every man has the right to self-governance. And so there is no reason that the government should be allowed to do something that the citizenry can't. Every individual should, there's justice is when the government and the citizenry are allowed to do the same things. And if the government's allowed to have guns, the people need to have guns as well.
So do you think the people should be able to own drones and tanks?
Well, I don't think there's any market for those things. I mean, if there were, there might be a small market for it out in the West, or, you know, other things. I don't think here in urban Minneapolis you can really see tanks going down. I think it's a good question. I wouldn't put a ban on it, but I would think the market would take care of that itself.
Yeah. I mean, there's a famous picture that President Obama recently released, the administration mm-hmm. of him shooting the shotgun
sure, yeah.
At Camp David, says mm-hmm. he likes to shoot skeet mm-hmm. and whatnot. That tends to be the argument, is that guns are for recreation, for hunting,
right.
or for shooting skeet, or whatever it is that mm-hmm. may happen, and that this idea that the citizenry could actually protect themselves mm-hmm. against the government, to many, that is in disbelief when you look at what the U.S. military has mm-hmm. in terms of the drones, the firepower. You know, what is a 30-round AR-15 going to do if
yeah.
there's drones circling your home and ready right. to send a hellfire mm-hmm. missile mm-hmm. right and blow up your house? You're done for. A gun's not going to protect you from that. But those are really good points that you brought up. I certainly thank you for coming on the show, Brandon.
Yeah.
And I wish you best in your endeavors working for Wells Fargo and and your family. And if you do decide to run in 2014, please do let us know.
Yeah, thank you.
So thank you very much for being on.
Thank you, Tony.
Thank you. Well, thank you to the general audience out there for tuning in once again to the Tony Hernandez Show. A reminder that we broadcast live every Saturday from 4 o'clock until 5 o'clock at the SCC TV studios in White Bear Lake, Minnesota. We also replay every Saturday from 4 o'clock to 5 o'clock on SPNN. I invite you to tune in, tell your friends and family about the Tony Hernandez Show, share this on YouTube, share it on your Facebook wall. May God bless you, may God bless America, and vaya con Dios.